church. It's good to see everybody here this morning. I am also thankful once again this week to be with family, to worship the Lord together. And let us do that by standing and singing our first hymn, 648. You guys will have to help me out, though. I'm not as familiar with this one as I am the other one, so... specific thing here this morning, and then I'll jump back in and close our prayer. Lord Jesus, I just thank you so much for this day. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the weather as well. Even through ups and downs in our temperatures, Lord, you still have a little bit of light shining through the clouds, Lord. I thank you for that. Lord, specifically as we pray together this morning, I just pray for this church. I pray for this body of believers. I pray that you continue to guide us and direct us. And Lord, open up doors that need to be open and shut doors that need to be shut. And Lord, just build this body of believers, strengthen us, guide us, and give us wisdom. Lord, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you that we can gather together as family. We pray all these things in your great and holy name. Amen. 6:54, change my heart, O God.
Well, good morning to everybody. Once again, glad to be here worshiping with our church family. Just a couple things, a couple reminders. The Women's Spring Brunch, the tickets are on sale now, and you can stop by the little table downstairs after church. They will be on sale until April 13th. Interesting, I believe that the lady speaking, her husband went to the same private school that I did for a little while back when I was in school. So I just kind of made that connection when I saw her name. Then a few of you have asked about Delene. She said, don't say anything from the pulpit. But she's
stand
not.
Stand
yeah. But she's not here to get after me. So I'll just give you just a quick update. We did have her appointment on this past Thursday. The original leak in her eye after the surgery is not leaking anymore, but there's a new leak that developed. And so the first one she said was a pinpoint leak. This one, the surgeon said, was even smaller. So I don't know how you get smaller than a pinpoint. But there's still a concern as long as there's that little opening there for infection and stuff. So she is going to try to go back to work with some restrictions, which the kind of work that she does, it's kind of hard to do effectively. But that's the plan for now. So just keep praying that heals up on its own without any problem. Her next appointment isn't for about 2.5 weeks. So the pressure was good. It went back up a little bit. So it's getting close to the range that they want it to be in. So that part's good. But they said that won't stabilize until all of the little leaks and stuff are done so that they can see how it's going. So anyway, thank you for your prayers for that. And then just continue to pray for the process of Rachel's passport. The gentleman there remembered her from our time in October, and he had a little compassion on her. And even though he said that, no, there was no way I can just stamp your passport right here and approve it, I will try to expedite it. So he was hoping in 3 to 5 days, business days from that time, that he could get her an answer that it was approved. So just keep praying for that. And then her arrangements to whatever she decides to fly or to try to drive back and pick up the passport. And then, of course, just pray for arrangements after that in getting to Poland and then to her destination in Ukraine. I think Mom and Dad are more nervous than she is. We'll just stop right there with that. We'll have our ushers come forward, take our morning off. Yes.
As of Thursday morning, my phone is officially dead. And so if you sent me a text and I did not respond, it's because I did not get it. So if you have something that needs to be put in the bulletin and things, either call me on my landline or my email, and all that information is in the church directory. I don't want anyone thinking I'm ignoring them. Thank you.
Father, we just thank you for this body of believers once again. Thank you that we have this place to come to worship, to encourage, to love each other, and to show our love for you. And we just ask you now, as we take an offering, that we would do it with grateful hearts. Continually giving thanks to you for all you do for us and all that you have blessed us with. And we just ask you to take our tithes and offerings here and do your work. In Jesus' name, amen.
this, maybe, and our wonderful keyboardist asked that was maybe a week break, and I thought that was fine. So I've got some other musicians that I thought I'd bring in. You can't see them, but we're going to do some stuff up here and use the blessing that technology can be. So is this on? If you'll please stand and join me.
Myself at a loss for words, and the fun.
Lord Jesus, I just ask that you just speak to us this morning. In your name we pray this. Amen. Children may be excused for children's church. Announcements. Two individuals recently said their memory verse, and so Bill Rappel, why don't you come up? Bill wanted it a Mounds, and he specifically said it had to be dark chocolate. So there you go. Congratulations. And then Tanner, he said his verse as well. He wanted a Reese's, so very good. I'll keep working on that, and I'll keep going to Walmart. So. Also, I have an announcement. Maury has been transferred out of the hospital. He's now in a rehabilitation facility, and I know that he loved to see. So I'm going to, and I'll give you the address afterward as well, but Barb was communicating. And so anyway, he's at a very lovely facility. I checked it out online. It's called St. Teresa's at Oxbow. It's in Brooklyn Park, so I've got the address. And she said that she loves, so I actually, I'm going to combine my two jobs. I think I have a cremation run tomorrow. And so afterward, I'll stop by and go visit him as well. And so if you're down the cities, wherever, I know that they live to see. I don't know how long he's going to be there, but I think it'd encourage him and lift his spirits if he saw some of you there. And then I started a new project. When I was in Mexico, they've been asking me if I would have my two commentaries translated into Spanish, and again, it all comes down to money. And so I decided to use some technology, and so this past week, I began a process, and so using Google Translate, I started translating my Proverbs commentary into Spanish. And so what I've done is, you can just go online, and so I just, I copy a chapter, a paragraph, put it into Google Translate, and it comes out in Spanish, I copy that, and I put it in a document, and then whenever I quote verses, I have the translation that they use down there, so then I go to Bible Gateway, I copy that, and so a chapter takes me about 2 hours, and so anyway, I'm going to do a chapter a day for the next months or whatever, and then just to see if it was going to work or not, I have a really good friend, she and her husband were in our church in Rush City, and she is Mexican, she had married this guy, anyway, they moved back to Mexico, and I sent it off to her, and I sent her the first 3 chapters, and she wrote back to me. She said, oh, that's really good. And so I was encouraged that the technology actually is good. And in fact, she said it was very timely. She says, I just started a study of Proverbs in my church. And so I'm going to supply her. And so what we'll do is, as I work on that, I'm sending the material to Ken, and then they share with Pastor Victor. And that's kind of what I do as well. Whatever topic I'll be preaching on, I just send the notes in English to Victor. They just put it through Google Translate, and then he reads it, and he smooths it out. Sometimes expressions that they, you know, Google will have, you know, not all Spanish is all Spanish. You know, there's regions and all that. And so then all I have to do is have Victor just read it through, make some changes. And so anyway, I hopefully within a year, I may not be able to afford to have a paper version of it, but I can give an electronic, and almost every one of them have laptops down there anyway, and so at least I can share the document or that. So anyway, you can pray about that. I'm working on that, and then if that goes well, then I'll move on to Psalms. And again, it takes time, but it's great to have the technology. Okay, so we are returning back to the book of James. When I was going to seminary, Karen and I moved to the metro area for 3 years. I'm not a metro person. I hated it. I tried to put it off as long as possible, but I got tired of commuting. And so for 3 years, we lived in the metro, lived up in Brooklyn Park, and I went to seminary. Karen got a full-time job, and so she got a job at a debt collecting agency. If you know anything about debt collecting people, they're very unique characters. If you are a debt collector, you're going to harass people to get money out of them. You have to have a big personality. And one of the ladies in particular that Karen told me about was quite the character. She was very brash. And anyway, one of her jobs was to collect for St. Catherine University. It's a Catholic school.
And so there was a man who had graduated from there. He was working for a Catholic church, and he wasn't paying off his school bill. And so this lady, what was her name? Was it Clancy?
No.
Okay. Shouldn't put you on the spot. Sorry about that. Anyway, what I remember about her was that one day she called that man. She said, "Now, in your church, do they take an offering on Sunday?" He said, "Oh, yes, they do." She said, "Okay, when you get the offering plate at the end of the service, I want you to throw the money up in the air. And whatever God wants, he'll take. And whatever lands back in the plate, you send to me." And she was kind of brass, but the point is she got her job done. As Karen got to know them and worked in the office and all that, she let them know that we were in the cities because I was training to be a pastor. And one of the questions they asked Karen was, "What's it like living with a religious person?" Like somehow I was bizarre. The other thing I thought about is they didn't think she was a religious person, apparently, by asking that as well. I think maybe they thought, maybe I sat around all day and just read the Bible or was in prayer, that I wasn't a normal person. And so I remember, because I knew they had some of those thoughts about that, they had a Christmas party. We went to the Christmas party, and just to kind of throw them off, at the Christmas party, I sat behind the bar and handed out beer just to throw them off. So didn't drink any, but I handed it out as well. So we're going to talk today about what does it mean to be religious. I'm assuming the fact that you're here, you would think of yourself as a religious person. Most likely, friends and relatives, they know if you're a regular church attendant, they have the idea that you are religious. So let's go to the Bible to define, according to James, what is a religious person, because it's not the same definition. So let me give you a working definition of what is a religious person. A religious person is one believing in and showing devotion or reverence for a particular deity, okay? So it could cover lots of different deities. It doesn't have to be our deity. And so a religious person is viewed that you believe in and you show devotion to a particular deity. Now, setting aside any specific religions, again, let's talk about how would you define a religious person, okay? For example, let's say you're at Walmart and you encounter a woman who has a head covering and she's wearing a long dress. That happens periodically when I go to Walmart in Pine. So I think, they're a religious person. They belong to some type of sect. So outwardly, they demonstrate the fact that they are religious. Or, it's not unusual. You see a person, they may have a necklace and it's got a cross on it. Or what I see now more days, I see tattoos with biblical expressions, religious semblance and all that. And so even on their bodies now, people kind of demonstrate that they have a devotion to a particular creed or a particular religion as well. Maybe you're driving in traffic and the car in front of you that just passed you at a high rate of speed has a fish on the back of it. They're telling you that they are a religious person, okay? And so there are different ways that we talk about that. And so we talk about being religious. The point is that in our services, we talk about God. We just got done singing songs that emphasize God and different aspects of God as well. We may recite passages of Scripture that are written about God or to God. We offer up prayers. We pray to God and we pray about things as well. Maybe you put money in the offering plate that shows your devotion to a particular ministry. You want to support that as well. And so what we're going to do this morning, we're going to talk about how does God define what a religious person is. And so with that in mind, we're going to look at this passage. This is toward the end of chapter 1. Again, it's following in the context of what he's been talking about not just listening to the word, but doing it as well. And so now he's going to get into some applications. So he says there, if anyone thinks he's religious, so that may be your opinion about you. It might be my opinion about me. I think I'm a religious person. So James says, okay, you think you're religious, but then he's going to give us three qualities that would demonstrate whether you're really religious or you're a fake. So he says, but does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. That's pretty harsh. James says, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this. And then he's going to give us two practical applications: to visit orphans and the widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained from the world. So what I want to do, I just want to spend some time looking at how James defines what is religion, and then he's going to give, and why would he choose those three categories for him that would define genuine religion. So let's talk about this. This is the guy, this is the person, as they look at themselves compared to other people, they view themselves as, well, I'm religious, okay? I'm trying to give that portrayal as well. So let's talk about what he is saying. So the person under discussion is one, as they think of themselves as being religious, as I'm pious, okay? Now, the Greek word that James uses denotes a scrupulous observance of religious exercise. Think about the background that James came out of. James would be an Orthodox Jew. You think about all the categories that you had to keep as an Orthodox Jew to demonstrate that you're religious. You think about all the tithes and all the offerings and even their outward clothing and all that. So if you're raised an Orthodox Jew the way James was, there were certain outward indicators that would let people know that you were religious. So that's the background from which he's writing. But now he's going to get into, well, that may be hypocritical. Now, this verse is used only one other time, or this word, and this is by Paul. Paul is giving the defense of his faith before Agrippa. He's talking about what he was like before he encountered Christ, and he uses the same word that James uses about being religious. He says, my manner of life from my youth, spent from the beginning among my own nation and in Jerusalem, is known by all the Jews. They have known for a long time, if they are willing to testify, that according to the strictest part of our religion, same word that James uses in our passage today, I have lived as a Pharisee. And so, as Saul looked back at his life, he gave all the outward indicators that he was pious, that he was religious, all the way from going to rabbinic school, to how he dressed, to what he ate and all that. So he said, when I was young, as I look back at my life, I gave outward indicators that I was religious, that I was a pious individual. So that's the background that James is talking about. And so bringing that into our culture today, it might be the fact that you regularly come to church, okay? The idea, when we think about that, you know, we have public worship, we might fast, we might pray, we may give. And again, in our setting, it describes a regular church attender who engages in the public worship on Sunday. He or she may participate in activities in the ministries of the church. They may contribute financially. They may give of their time. This religious person, again, they may put an emblem on the back of their car or wear religious clothing as well. Now, I'm going to show you a picture. About 2 years ago, early on in my funeral ministry, we had a funeral at this magnificent and huge Catholic church down in South St. Paul. It was St. Augustine. When I walked in there, everything about the building exuded piousness. I mean, everything about it. The man who died had been a Knight of Columbus. And therefore, have you ever been around the Knights of Columbus? They actually have uniforms that are like militaristic. They actually had swords in their scabbards and all that. And so as I'm working the visitation, I think I jokingly said to be a Knight of Columbus, you got to be at least 80. And so anyway, they were all down there in all their full regalia, and they marched like they're in the military. And at each time, there'd be two men at the head and the foot of the casket with their swords and all that. And every 15 minutes, two more men would walk in. They kind of salute each other. They kind of say a prayer for the dead. And then they'd switch out and all that. So everything about it. And then as we brought the casket up out of the basement and we brought it into the back of the church, it was huge. The men stood with their swords crossed, and we walked under them as we put the casket toward the front. And the fascinating thing for me was the entire service was in Latin. Everything was in Latin, very ornate and all that. And so to me, it was fascinating for me to observe it. I wouldn't want to continue that way, but it was just fascinating. And the point is that they give the impression that they were a very pious, a very religious church. And so we're talking about at least outward indicators. What James is going to get at, but what about your heart? What are you actually manifesting? So what James is going to do, James is going to say, okay, let's really define what is a religious person. And here's the fascinating thing. The first thing he talks about is your tongue. He talks about how you talk. And so the point is, I could be religious externally, and I may get it on a good show. I may wear the right clothes. I may go to church at the right time. But James says the biggest indicator is what comes out of your mouth. And my mouth reveals a lot about me. So let's pursue that as well. So the first thing James says here, okay, you think you're religious. You're giving that impression. You want people to think of you as you're a pious person. So the first thing is, but you don't bridle your tongue. It says, if you don't bridle your tongue, you've just deceived yourself. And then shockingly says, your religion is worthless. James is being harsh in particular because he's trying to destroy people who have the mentality that you're better because you happen to be in church right now. You're better because you do this or that. And so again, what's fascinating about James will often go to the tongue. In fact, as we work our way through the book of James, he's going to talk about our tongue almost more than anything else, okay? And that image of the bridle, he's talking about a horse. In chapter 3, he's going to go back to that image as well. You think about, have you been on a horse that you lost the bridle and you lost all control of that horse? James says that's the way your mouth is sometimes. And you lost all control as well. In fact, when we get into chapter 3, he's going to have this long section on what the Bible has to say about the tongue. And so as I thought about that in particular, when I talk about the tongue, my mind went back as I wrote my commentary. There are so many proverbs that talk about the tongue. So let me just kind of work you through some of these verses in the book of Proverbs and see if they convict you as they convicted me. Think about this. Anger can be expressed. He says, a hot-tempered man stirs up strife, but he who is slow to anger quiets contention. Another sin of the tongue would be boasting. Do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day may bring forth. Let another praise you and not your own mouth, someone else and not your own lips. Another sin of the tongue is deception. A worthless person, a wicked man, goes about with crooked speech, winks with the eyes, signals with his feet, points with his finger, with perverted heart, devises evil, continually sowing discord. Dishonesty. A lying tongue hates those it hurts, and a flattering mouth works ruin. Gossip. A lying tongue hates those it hurts, and a flattering... Oh, sure, it didn't jump. Okay. There we go. A perverse man stirs up dissension, and a gossip separates close friends. Then the last one would be slander. Whoever goes about slandering reveals secrets, but he who is trustworthy in spirit keeps a thing covered. As I look back on my 65 years of going to church, either as a pastor's kid or as a pastor, I can remember specific conversations in church where individuals betrayed the fact that you might be religious, but you're not godly. I can remember comments made in business meetings. I can think of comments made at the end of the service where people would talk, or even just gossip taking place. What James is getting at, you might think you're religious, but your tongue reveals who you really are. And so what James is warning us is that just outward demonstrations don't mean anything. So James says the person with an uncontrolled tongue reveals that his religion is worthless. It is worthless or without value in the sense that his religion has not substantially changed that person. Well, that's the whole point. Our faith is supposed to change us. We're not supposed to be the same people. And therefore, James says, you can go through all the outward practice of being religious, but if it doesn't change who you fundamentally are, it's actually worthless. It's not going to benefit you, and it's not going to benefit the people around you. So this person may have accepted Christ as his Savior, but he has not made Christ the Lord of his life. Her religion is also worthless in the sense it hasn't benefited those who live around them. Instead of building others up, this person's uncontrolled tongue does a lot of damage. So that's James' concern. And says, and that person, what's happened? The end result, it is deception. Okay? Again, that's what he says there. You've actually deceived your own heart. And James has talked about being self-deceived a couple of times already in this as well. Remember what he said back in verse 22? Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. We can pack up a lot of Bible knowledge in our head, but if it doesn't change the way we live, James says it's a waste of knowledge. And so James is talking about that as well. So the first area, James says, true religion is revealed by what you say, what comes off your tongue. Look at the next area. The next area has to do with engaging in ministry. And so James says here, religion that is pure and undefiled before God. And I want to catch that. There were many times that I was concerned about what other people in church thought of me without giving any thought about what God thought of me. And so the point is, I can waltz in the church, I can wear the right clothes, although Jeff has told me I should not wear the shirt anymore. Apparently it messes with the pixels, okay? So, And so the point is, I can show up in church, I can look good, I can talk good. That really doesn't matter. The point is, I can fool you, I cannot fool God. And God's actually the one who's actually determining today if being here is actually of any benefit. He knows whether being here today is actually going to change you or it's just what you do. Okay? And that's why that thing, probably that phrase more than anything else caught my idea. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God, that's the nature of religion. Religion by its very nature is always external because we want to impress somebody else. Okay? We do that all the time. You know, we can identify another religion by how they dress, the externals as well. James says the thing that really matters is what does God think? So religion that is pure and undefiled, that is free from contamination, okay? And so the point is that type of religion, rather than just being an external thing that we try to impress someone else, James says, let me see something practical. And look at the area he talks about. It's to visit orphans and widows in their affliction. Now go back to the early church. What was the first problem the early church faced? We got too many widows in our church, okay? A lot of older Jews who had lived out in the dispersion had come back to Jerusalem toward the end of their life. And as it normally happens, men tend to die before wives. And so there were a lot of widows in the church. And their needs were not being met. And so the church had to do that. And so that's why James is focusing on that was the problem in their church, okay? So James says, what I want to know is I want to know how are you caring for the most vulnerable in your community? And in James' day, it was widows and orphans. And again, we know that from Acts chapter 16. We're told there in those days when the number of the disciples was increasing, the Grecian Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. And the apostles realized, okay, we have to address that. We got to take care of that. And therefore, they found individuals that they could give that job to. They had to be godly and all that, but they assigned that as well. We know even going back to the Old Testament, God was always concerned with Israel about what? How they took care of the most vulnerable. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 10. Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no longer stubborn. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, the mighty, the awesome God, who is not partial and takes no bribes. And then he executes justice for the fatherless and the widow and loves the sojourner, giving him food and clothing. You read through the Old Testament, God was always concerned about the stranger. He's always concerned about the widow. He's always concerned about the child that did not have a father. I came across a great illustration. I want to show you a picture. This guy, his name, he's passed away now, but his name was Henry Nouwen, and he was a Roman Catholic priest from the Netherlands. In a book I read written by Philip Yancey called Soul Survival, he used this man as an illustration. Just listen to the story. It says here that this man was a noted psychologist, a great theologian. He wrote many books. He taught at Notre Dame and at Yale. He authored 16 books. But at the height of his academic career, he resigned his professorship and he moved to Toronto, Canada, to work at a community that cared for the mentally and physically disabled. So the man who once commanded $10,000 for a speaking engagement now cared for a young man named Adam, who was the weakest and the most disabled person in the community. Philip Yancey was so fascinated, he went to visit this well-known author, this man who commanded a lot of money. He went to visit him, and he writes in his book, he said, as I watched him care for Adam, I must confess that I felt that this man was wasting his theological talent. But then he said, he was talking to Nouwen, and here's what he had to say. He said, through this experience, he had learned to love Adam, to truly love him. In the process, he had learned what it must be for God to love us. Spiritually uncoordinated, mentally disabled, unable to respond with what must seem like God is inarticulate grunts and groans. And so this man of great intellect who had, you know, impacted many people, he spent the rest of his life caring for the disabled. But the point is, he learned, that's probably how God looks at me. Unable to articulate to God exactly what he means to me. And so I thought about that, and I thought of some practical ways. How could we do that? When our children were young, and we pastored in Waseca, we had an older couple. The man had had a stroke, and so they could no longer come to church. And so when our children were young, every Tuesday, Karen and I were at their house every Tuesday at 2 o'clock to visit them. And I could tell they looked forward to that. There's one day in particular that Elizabeth wasn't feeling well, and so Karen and Elizabeth stayed home. I remember as I knocked on the door and Mrs. Sheridan looked out and saw just me, I wasn't quite sure she was gonna open the door because it's just the pastor and all that. But the point is that we demonstrated to our kids that, you know, and I could tell they looked forward to that visit. A couple years later, we had an older couple. They had been missionaries in their early days. Anyway, they had retired to move to Waseca, and so they lived two doors down. And so when Merle, he began to show signs of dementia. His wife had to put him in the nursing home, and so we wanted to give him some contingency. So every Tuesday at 2 o'clock, we went to the nursing home,
and we brought our two little kids there and just spent an hour talking to Merle. The reason why we did that is because when I grew up, nursing homes freaked me out because the smells and the weird old people. I wanted our kids, and that's what happened. When we walk into that nursing home, our two little kids would just go off running. And they'd be with all the old people, and so we kind of acclimated them that older people, they're actually normal, okay? And so we'd actually sit around, and so we would talk to Merle. We'd interact with the people. I learned that you cannot win playing dominoes with people with dementia because they always win, okay? And but the point is, you know, for that time until Merle passed away, it was fun to give him that constancy that he knew that we were always going to show up. And then a couple years later, there was another couple in town. Karen would work part-time. They ran a plant nursery. And Karen would work on Mondays when I'd be with the kids. He'd get to, you know, be around normal people and adults and all that and got to play with plants. Anyway, when his wife, Millie, came down with dementia, Clayton had to leave the business, and he just cared for his wife. And so we decided, and what happened, they were going to a larger free church in town, but the loudness and the more contemporary music really agitated Millie. And so because he loved his wife, he started coming to our small, quiet Baptist church that just did hymns at the time. And so we knew that they came to our church for that particular reason. It wasn't that they chose us, but at that point, we met their needs. And so again, Clayton, he ran a business, and then he was an amazing chef. He made I've had the best meals in my life in his house. And so we decided one day a week we would go to the house so he could get out, and Millie felt comfortable and our kids are well-behaved. We'd simply go in the house and we babysat her while he could go out, maybe go check on the business, maybe go buy some groceries. But the point is, we thought, you know, that's how we can care for this man. And, you know, she lived for about 6 months before she passed away, but at that point we felt we met their need. We ministered to them. And so I think about that as well. You know, we have some lovely widows in our church. How often do you visit them? The one thing I've learned from my mom is that when my dad died, she kind of went on an island. All of a sudden, you don't know. You know, you've always been viewed as a couple. You're not a couple anymore. Then all of a sudden, we don't mean to be rude, but we all of a sudden, we just don't feel comfortable around them anymore and all that. So I'd encourage you, why don't you pick one of the widows and start hanging around them. Become a regular part of your life. Here's another area. Maybe get committed to Awana. You know, there are some kids who come to Awana that maybe come from difficult homes. We started doing this at Rush City. We started adopting certain kids, and that we could get, maybe the parents wouldn't give. And so some of our people started saying, no, I'm going to pick you up every Sunday. And when you come to church, you're going to sit with my family. And we had a number of kids through that came to know the Lord because a particular family adopted that kid and started bringing them. So not only we didn't want them just to come on Wednesday, we wanted them to be a part of church on Sunday. And so there's lots of things about that. And so I would encourage you, you know, come to Awana. Find a kid, start connecting with a kid as well. I say, you know, go on a mission. In fact, next Sunday, John, I've asked John to give a report. You know, going to Mexico, I think it blessed John more than it blessed them. You know, John, we talked on the phone this week. He was actually driving truck out of Spooner, and we had a really good talk. And he was just going on, and I said, John, you know, we need to honor mission trips. You're talking next Sunday. You know, show some pictures and all that. The point is that when you're down there and you see what their needs are, you realize, man, my life is so good. And the point is, you know, God has given us this ability. And so I just want to encourage you, you know, find an area that of need that's maybe being neglected and minister to that as well. So if you're religious, one, you're going to watch what you say. Two, you're going to involve in ministry. And then the third area is your morality. He asks us, and then the final thing is to keep oneself unstained from the world. Now, when James talks about the world, think about who he's writing to. He's writing to people who used to be Orthodox Jew,
Now, because of the persecution, they've responded to the Christ. Now they're living out in the Roman world. What do we know about the Roman world? You read the first book of 1 Corinthians. We're talking about rampant paganism, rampant immorality, okay? And so the problem is they're now living out in the world, and they're now being exposed to the underbelly of the world. And James says, don't be like that. Don't let the world begin to change your values and the way you live. To me, the greatest commentary on that is out of 1 John. Do not love the world. We're talking about the world system, the world's values, okay? So do not love the world or anything in the world, because if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the man or woman who does the will of God lives forever. So James was concerned. You're living out in the world now. You're seeing all these other things, these other world values. Do not let the world force you into its values. As a Christian, you have to live an alternative life. And so that's what James is saying. And what he's warning about is that if you don't impact the world will impact you. And when the world starts impacting you, you'll no longer have a message. My greatest concern for a lot of American evangelical churches that try to be attractive to the world, eventually you don't have a message. In that sense, if people can come into your church and they feel completely comfortable, there's no need to change. Again, not that we artificially make them uncomfortable, but the point is we should be very clear about our message. So, having gone through this, would you be bold enough to say that you're religious? Based upon what James has to say, he says, okay, we can do it externally, but there's some indicators. You reveal you're religious by what you say, you reveal it by how you care for the most vulnerable, and you reveal it by your avoiding the world and its things. So with that in mind, let's close in a word of prayer. As we gather on the communion table, I'm going to read to you a devotional. I want you to really feel the weight of what we're about to do. So let's have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, again, we're thankful that we can gather together on a regular basis, which would indicate that we are religious people, that we have a devotion to you. Again, we can demonstrate that externally, and we may even fool some other people because we know how to put on a good show. But James was concerned that the people that he was writing to were merely making it an outward show, and therefore he wanted to define what is religion that God is impressed with. And so the three categories are fascinating because you talked about, first of all, our mouth and what comes off our lips. What do we say? What we say reveals a lot about who we really are. And so help us to be careful about our words. Number two, we need to demonstrate it by how we engage in ministry. And again, we need to engage in ministry to people who can't pay us back. We need to engage in ministry with those who are the most neglected, the most overlooked. And so help us, Lord, to be more aware of that and to notice the people who would normally be overlooked. And finally, we demonstrate our devotion to you by our detachment from the world, that we see the sin of this world. We see its emptiness. We see its futility. Help us, Lord, to fight against allowing the values of the world to become our values. Help us, Lord, not to value the things that the world values because those things are passing away. Help us, Lord, to be devoted to that which is eternal. And so now as we move to the communion table, I pray that you might prepare our hearts to think about the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and what his sacrifice demonstrated on behalf of the Father. And so we pray your blessing as we gather around the table in Jesus' name. Amen. A number of years ago, a small book was written by a pastor that I greatly respect. His name is John Piper. And John Piper, a number of years ago, wrote a book simply 50 Reasons Why Jesus Came to Die. And so what I'd like to do over the next couple of months, I'd like to read his devotion. To me, it gives more of a weightiness to what we're about to do as opposed to just kind of go through the process. And so what he does is I'm just going to read it, and he's going to back it up with scripture as well. So just listen to his words. I want you to think about the weight of them as well. He writes, "If God were not just, there would be no demand for his son to suffer and die. If God were not living, There would be no willingness for his son to suffer and die. But God is both just and loving. Therefore, his love is willing to meet the demands of his justice. God's law demanded, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might, Deuteronomy 6, verse 5. But we have all loved other things more. That's what sin is, dishonoring God by preferring other things over him and acting on those preferences. Therefore, the Bible says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3, 23. So we glorify what we enjoy most, and it isn't God. Therefore, sin is not small, because it is not against a small sovereign. The seriousness of an insult rises with the dignity of the one who is insulted. The creator of the universe is infinitely worthy of respect and admiration and loyalty. Therefore, failure to love him is not trivial, it is treason. It defames God and destroys human happiness. Since God is just, he does not sweep over these crimes, or he does not sweep these crimes under the rug of the universe. He feels a holy wrath against them. They deserve to be punished, and he has made this clear, that the wages of sin is death, and the soul who sins shall die, Ezekiel 18:4. There is a holy curse hanging over all sin. Not to punish would be unjust. The demeaning of God would be endorsed. A lie would reign at the core of reality. Therefore, God says, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law and to do them. But the love of God does not rest with the curse that hangs over all sinful humanity. He is not content to show wrath, no matter how holy it is. Therefore, God sends his own son to absorb his wrath and to bear the curse for all who trust him. He quotes Paul out of Galatians 3, verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. This is the meaning of the word propitiation, which is quoted in Romans chapter 3 and verse 25. Propitiation refers to the removal of God's wrath by providing a substitute. The substitute is provided by God himself. The substitute, Jesus Christ, doesn't cancel the debt. He absorbs it and diverts it from us to himself. God's wrath is just, and it was spent and not withdrawn. So his final thought is this: let us not trifle with God or trivialize his love. We will never stand in awe of being loved by God until we reckon with the seriousness of our own sin and the justice of his wrath against us. But when by grace we awaken our own unworthiness, then we may look at the suffering and death of Christ and say, in this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the wrath-absorbing propitiation for our sin. I remember when our daughter-in-law had gone through discipleship lessons, was coming to our church, and she came in to talk to the deacons she wanted to get, or elders she wanted to get baptized that year. She said, when Dave asked me early on when she started dating her son if I was a Christian, I said yes, because based upon what little I knew, I thought I was, because I went to church. But she says, when I started coming to church, I began to hear about sin and God's holiness. She said, I never understood the awfulness of my sin. All I heard when I went to church was that God loved me and had a wonderful plan for my life. But now that I understand sin, now I am saved. So I invite the men to come forward as we gather on the table and as we pass out the elements. As you partake of them, I want you to feel God's wrath and God's love. Because God is holy, he has to judge. The point is, he poured out his wrath not on us. He poured his wrath out on his son. And so as we partake of these elements today, I want you to think about that weightiness. Scott, before we pass out the bread, would you just say a word of prayer, just thanking God for his sacrifice?
Father, we come to you, and we are so grateful that in your love you prepared ahead your son to come pay the price for our sin, and we just thank you for the opportunity to serve you, to love you, to be partakers of your kingdom through the work of Jesus Christ. Thank you for his death.
Jesus told his disciples as they had the bread, said, "This is my body. It was broken for you. Eat this in memory of me." Bill, before we pass out the cup, would you just thank the Lord for the sacrifice of his blood?
Holy Father, thank you so much for providing your son to allow him to die. And his blood, as you said, for us to cover our sin. Thank you that we can have forgiveness of sin because of that.
Testament, we are taught that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. So Jesus says, drink this in memory of me. So Heavenly Father, as we conclude our service today, we trust that our religion was pleasing to you, that we recognize by drinking of this cup, which represents the blood was a demonstration of the wrath of God. Someone had to die to pay for human sin. And so we're thankful, Lord, that you demonstrated your holiness by sending your son, and you demonstrated your love by sacrificing your son, that he took upon himself your wrath. And so help us to have an even greater appreciation for our salvation, to cherish you, so that this week when we engage in what appears to be religion, it'll be authentic, because we are concerned not what impresses other people, but rather what truly impresses and pleases you. Pray your blessing as we dismiss this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Apparently he wanted to help close us out here this morning. Let's stand.
By her
side by side, and we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come. All praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son. And all praise to the Spirit, who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Guess that's my challenge to each and every one of us when we're out in the community, that people will look and say they love Jesus. And they'll know that by our love. Have a great week.